I like to pray for those who have been baptized and bless them. And so I'll invite all of you, don't mind, you just stand with me. Everyone stand up, we are going to pray and seek the Lord. Father, I thank you for calling all of us to belong to your family. And those who are baptized in the last 6 months, can you just lift up your hands? I want to pray a blessing over you. And those who are baptized here, not only we welcome you into family, in Jesus' name, I bless you with a new understanding of the new life, and the power of the resurrection will become something that you'll experience in the coming days. I speak blessing upon you against all curses that have been plaguing your life before. And I speak the exchange, the divine exchange, with the blessings that come through Jesus in his resurrection. And Father, this day as we try to understand a little bit more about the power of the resurrection, so that we'll experience it in the days ahead, Holy Spirit, we invite you, ask you, and ask that you will download to us a revelation, not only of the cross, but of the resurrection. We ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Please be seated. Today I want to talk about the resurrection, and I want to begin with a quiz. And this quiz has got three answers, and I'm going to ask you to take a vote today. The question is this: what was the first words of Jesus? Everybody knows the last words of Jesus before he was crucified. So my question is this: what was the first word of Jesus when he rose from the grave? All right, so some of you say, maybe I know, I don't know. Let me give you a few clues. All right, the first one is, could it be shalom? You know, normally shalom is a Hebrew word, but every time they see each other, this is a very common word they use. And so what other words do they use? Well, maybe greetings. Some of us like to use, greetings. All right, that's the second word that's possible. The third word is rejoice, which is somewhat of a command. It's what we call an imperative mode. All right, three choices. All right, now I want you to select one. How many of you think the first word Jesus spoke was shalom? Can I see your hand? Yes, I see quite a few hands. Good. How many of you say the second word, greetings? Anyone? Yes, I see one or two words. Good. How many of you think this the word, rejoice? Can I see your hand? Thank you, quite a lot of you. How many of you say, I really don't know? Can you put out your hand? Let me tell you, I didn't know until recently what was the first word of Jesus. So if you didn't know, you are in the majority. All right, most people don't know what's the first word. Okay, how do you get the word rejoice? Let's verify it shortly, and then you see where the word first word is. All right, the passage I'm going to read to you for today is from chapter 28 of the book of Matthew. All right, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, and that will be the passage for today. It's 11 o'clock. It's a nice program we have. Speaker usually have 1 hour to speak. Okay. So I'll try to keep within my time, because this topic is the most important topic of all the teaching of Scripture. Chapter 28, and as I read this story, there are three things I'm going to talk to you about. I'm going to talk to you about what happened on Easter. It's not in your notes, but it's from this passage. What happened on Easter morning? First. Second, I'm going to talk to you about what the resurrection life means. What does resurrection body looks like? Okay, my notes are found in number four, point number four. So I start with point number four. All right. So I'll explain that. Third one, I will touch on briefly on the evidence that Jesus rose again from the dead. Three things. Then I'm going to give a response call. Because this is the most important topic in all of Scripture, the Bible describes by the prophet has so much to talk about the resurrection. All right. Resurrection simply means to rise from the dead. Now let's read together from chapter 28, Matthew, 4-8 verses. Verse 1, after the Sabbath, at dawn, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a, number one, a violent earthquake. The Greek text says great earthquake. So great earthquake probably would be Richter number 8 and above. It's a very, very severe, a violent, a great earthquake. Underline that word, great earthquake. For an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. He sat on it. Take note what he did. He sat on the round stone on the top of it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were also afraid of him that they were shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen. Underline that word, risen. Just as he said. Just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples. Three words. He is risen. Come and see. Go and tell. Three things. He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I've told you. So the woman hurried away from the tomb and afraid, yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. Greetings, he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers, and go to Galilee. There they will see me. Right. The word here is, where does it say that Jesus said the word, whatever word, where does he say? So what did Jesus, what was the first word here? Ah, greetings, good. However, so where does he say rejoice? Well, the translator felt the way to translate this word is greetings. After when you meet someone, you say greetings, right? Or in Hebrew, we always say shalom. If it's a lot of people, we say shalom aleichem. If you're an American, you say howdy. Okay. Or how do you do? Now, the word here, greetings, is what Jesus said. But this word greetings, in the Greek word, root word, is the word kairo, which means rejoice. Okay, it's more accurately translated as rejoice. That is the word, although the translators use the word greetings. The Greek word used is kairete, means all of you, rejoice. And before that, this woman already felt rejoicing. And the word that you get before this, before Jesus said so, the woman had already, the Bible said, filled with joy. The Greek text says they were filled with great joy. Great appears twice in this short passage. A great earthquake, a great joy. So, in grammar, we call this an imperative mode, meaning to say, this is what you're supposed to do. Rejoice. Rejoice over what? Over the fact that Jesus has now risen. All right. So those of you who voted rejoice, you got it right. But you didn't know why you got it right. Okay. So we call it a fluke shot. Because the title of today's talk is Rejoice. So Jesus commands, rejoice, because the resurrection event marks a new beginning. A new beginning of a new creation. Just now you saw a video presentation of the first creation. The resurrection is a marker for the new creation that God is going to do. We have more time, we'll talk about that. But now, let's trace what happened on the Easter morning. Now, the first thing it says that it was after the Sabbath, it was a Sunday morning, it was before dawn or at dawn time, roughly between, it is right here, is about mid-spring, so dawn comes at around 7, and so the woman came, and he went to the tomb, it is said. Now, give you a big background. First of all, where's this tomb? The Bible says the tomb is near to the place of the crucifixion, a Golgotha, which in Latin is Calvary. It's the same place. If you stand outside the tomb of the where Jesus was entombed, and you just look across from the front of the tomb, you see the Golgotha, the place of the skull, the place of death. Because the resurrection speaks of overcoming death. But there are six things that happened on Easter morning, and I want to quickly run away. The first thing that happened, can anybody, what actually first happened? So you know what time it is, you know who was there, and you know where it was, right? So the place is the tomb, just about 200 meters across a little valley. That's Golgotha. Now, on Easter morning, what happened? Easter begins with E. It says there was an earthquake, okay? What kind of earthquake? The Bible says a great earthquake. Well, the translator says violent. The Greek used the word mega. It was a mega earthquake. That means the whole of Jerusalem, which is just nearby, is all shaken. Nobody is asleep at this time. The entire town is awake. And the sisters, there's a group of women who came. Maybe there are two groups. We don't know. But here he mentions the two Marys. So there was a big shaking. Can you tell me, when do you see events in the Bible where there was earthquake when God was involved? Do you remember when Peter was being put in prison later on, and then God was wanted to show that the religious folks that you cannot keep my servant? What did God do? Peter was set in between two soldiers at midnight. God cause an earthquake. There's a shaking. Sometimes God has to shake us and shake the land to get our attention. So there was a great earthquake. So all Jerusalem was awake. And for sure, all the 17 soldiers were awake. Because the Bible says that the soldiers were put in charge. So if there are four watches, each watch four soldiers, you get 16 soldiers. And generally, you have what is called guard commanders, so 17 burly soldiers, but they were shaken awake. Nobody sleeps at the resurrection of Jesus. Not only Jesus arose, but every day, everybody must awake, be awake. And God wants to make a statement. He shakes the land. When Paul was in prison, God wanted to make a statement. What did he do? In a place called Philippi, God shook the prisoner until all the doors opened. So shaking is God's statement. Guys, wake up. This is a very important event. Earthquakes happen. And then second, what happened? We call him angel. An angel. This is must be one of the big ones. Because the angel came down from heaven. There's a special assignment. This was assigned to him long before the world was created, that he will have the privilege to go down on that special day. And then he would do something. But the angel must appear. And he did something. Easter is not spelled like this. Easter starts with an S. He had to do something. It's called a stone. The Bible says he rolled away the stone. What was his assignment? In all eternity, he was given one assignment. Roll away the stone. The stone is about 2 meters wide, and it's 2 meters in diameter. It's about 10 mm in thickness. So if you are an engineer here, do a quick calculation, and you'll get a total of 1.2 cubic meters of stone, and it's times about 2.5. You get over 2 tons. And this guy must be a big angel. You know why he was a big angel? He not only looked big, but he had very big illumination as well. He was so shining. So much so that the soldiers are already terrified by the big earthquake. Now see this big man shining, brilliant like lightning. And then the Bible says because the stone was rolled away, they were terrified. But what did the angel come to do? After rolling away the stone, he sat on the stone. You know, when you finish your job, you sit down. In all eternity, only one assignment, roll away the stone. Hey, that tells you how important this job was. So he sat on the stone. Why did he sit on the stone? Well, obviously waiting for some visitors, waiting for the women to come. The men were too lazy to get up, even though there was an earthquake. Only the women came, and they came to see the tomb. So there was a stone that was rolled away. And then, what else? Tea. Well, tea stands for two things. One, the soldiers were terrified. When you don't know God in a personal way, the day will come and you'll be terrified to meet God. And to meet just an angel is already terrifying enough. What about God? Soldiers were terrified, the Bible says, so terrified that they couldn't even move. They were paralyzed like dead men. That's what it says. They couldn't move. They could see, but they couldn't move. Was too frightening for them. But the most important was the angel had three things to say. Three things. Three. Three messages. You know what the messages were? Very simple. You have it on the keywords there. First word, risen. That means Jesus has resurrected. He's not here. It's obvious that he's alive. What is the second one? Come and see. What's the third word? go and tell. So there are three short messages that is proclaimed at the resurrection. That's the right message, not only for the woman, but for all of us. First of all, we must acknowledge that Christ is risen. So there are three messages. Christ is risen. You must acknowledge it, you must believe it, you must receive it. Why? Because you cannot be saved from hell without believing in this resurrection. Paul, writing to the Romans, said, if you will believe in your heart, first, before you believe in your heart, what do you believe in your heart? Paul said, you need to believe in your heart that Jesus rose from the dead. You must believe he has risen. You must believe in a living Savior, not in a dead one. Believe in your heart that Jesus rose from the dead. That's the first thing. And then you must confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. That means he's king over all. All right. Then what's the next instruction the angels told the girls, or the ladies, or the sisters? Come and see. You know, you need to come to Jesus. If you are the first time here, you need to come to Jesus. And you need to see. The word see here is very interesting. It says it's the seeing with the desire to understand what is going on. See with understanding. Those of you who are old members of the church, you know there's a word, it's called Edon. Okay? All of you should know this word. Edon is not just seeing with the eyes, but also be able to understand what is going on. That's the invitation. Come and see. See what? See where he lay. And then what? Go and tell. If you believe, you will go and tell. You cannot keep it to yourself. That's the instruction. Last instruction, go and tell. If you believe, you will go and tell. If you go and tell, your faith will grow. Jesus later on said, go and tell. So three messages that is connected with the resurrection. So what's the first message of the resurrection? Acknowledge Jesus risen, that he has risen. Two, come and see. And lastly, go and tell. All right. Simple words. That's the instruction from God, but through the angel that lives today. That's what we're supposed to do with the resurrection. You need to see and understand why Jesus rose. You need to see and understand what is the meaning of a resurrection body. All right? And then let me finish the Easter story. After that, so you know already, E stands for? Sorry? E stands for? Earthquake. A stands for? Angel. S for? Stone roll away. T stands for? Three messages. E stands for the excitement of an obedience. I will talk more about this. They were excited about what? And they're excited that Jesus rose. You see, they received the message. The woman received the message and they were so excited. So there was, you can say, there's also an exchange. What was the exchange? The exchange was that they were full of misery and unbelief and fear and despair and depression and disappointment and disillusion because Jesus seems to be finished when he died on the cross. They never expected Jesus to come back. And so there was an exchange in what? In their emotion, from despair to hope, from grief to happiness, joy. Jesus himself told them long before the crucifixion that you are going to grieve, but it will be changed to joy that Jesus had predicted. So there was a change in their attitude. So what does the Bible say? They were afraid and yet filled with joy. The word is filled with great joy. Take note. The Greek text says great. Great earthquake, great joy. Great earthquake is God making a statement. Great joy is our response when we believe. But it makes no difference to those who don't believe. A great event has taken place, therefore they had great joy. And then because they had that exchange, they had one more blessing. Well, you can say rejoice was a command, but it's also, I would call, be rejoice because of revelation. Okay, this is a good word for you to remember. A revelation means Jesus showing himself to them. When did Jesus show himself to them? After they have believed. After they went to tell on the way. Can you take note of what the Bible says? If you got your Bible, you read here, the woman hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with great joy, and ran to tell the disciples. Then suddenly, everything is sudden in this particular story. The resurrection is a sudden thing for those who are uninstructed. He says, suddenly Jesus met them. Jesus met them. Do you know something? Jesus would like to meet you too. Jesus meets, but only on the basis of your faith in his resurrection. Right, that's Easter. Trying to remember what happened on Easter? There was the earthquake, there was the angel, there was the stone roll away, there was the three messages, there was the exchange, and then there was the revelation of the Lord Jesus. Jesus met them. Who was the first people who had the joy to see Jesus personally after he had been crucified? It was this woman. Jesus met them. And I hope you will meet with Jesus. When you look forward to looking for Jesus, Jesus will meet you suddenly. All right. Now, the second thing, I've just talked to you about what happened on Easter morning, so you must know six things that happened on Easter morning. So it's not just one boom, one statement. There are many things that happened. This is just a quick summary. Now, the second thing I want to talk about is what is the resurrection body? Okay, our resurrection body. It's not, it's in the point four in the notes. I give a very brief one. But I like to explain this part. Many people don't realize that the resurrection body is a body. It's a body. It's not just a spirit like a ghost. A resurrected body is a body that is visible, that is physical. Yet, the first thing you need to know is that yes, I've given you under SingNet. All right, let me run it through quickly because of time, but you need to remember this. What's the difference between your body and a resurrected body? The first of all, S stands for supernatural. This body is a supernatural body. Sometimes the Bible calls it a spiritual body, but because spiritual may conjure the idea of a spirit that is not visible, so a supernatural body is a body that is not the same as our body, which is natural body. All of us have a natural body. I think so. You have any doubt that you are natural? All right, all of us, natural means we have eyes, we have legs, we have a sense, we've got five senses, we've got bodies that is functioning and we try to keep it going. But supernatural is different. The molecules are different, not the same substance. But the outward appearance looks similar. Only thing is, you look better. I always think of, you know, my old mother died when she was 86, and she was quite old when she died. But so my brother and sister always come to October, we say, let's go to the go to the graveyard, but you know, I never bring myself to go to the her grave, because I always think of her as a woman of 33. Well, I once saw her photograph when she was 33. Man, my mother was gorgeous. She was a good-looking woman. And I think when I get to heaven, that's the picture I have when I meet her. That's a picture. Not that old lady that was a bit decrepit, but no, that young lady. So, supernatural. Second, there is an idea of invisible. It can be invisible to the eye, but it can also be visible. You choose. So you can toggle between either one. That's what is a resurrected body. Three, N stands for no aging. You don't need all this SK number 2, SK number 3, all this Hua Chuan Ping. I was talking to my staff just last week, you know, after our happiness group, and I was having lunch with my staff, and I said, hey, you all know about what is a resurrection body or not? Then I said, no aging, you know. Wow, I got all their attention. They paid attention. And then someone said, you know, you don't have to spend money on cosmetics. You save a lot of money. Do you know something? You will not need any anti-aging material, because you will not age. You stay at 33. You always stay young. So don't worry, those of us who lost hair, lost teeth, whatever, when you get a resurrected body, you'll be all, no aging will take place. You'll never grow old. I like that song I used to sing in Sunday school many years ago when I was a new Christian. Singing about heaven, we always say, in a land where we'll never grow old. All right, nothing wrong with growing old. But you see, after you go too old, we die. But there's no aging. Third, that's no aging. Fourth, it's a glorified body. That means it has got glory, outshining, just like the angels, shining glory, something glorious, something to be desired. Jesus demonstrated this before his crucifixion and in chapter 17 of Matthew, where Jesus took the disciples up to the Mount of Transfiguration and he transformed into his resurrected form. And the three disciples that were there were awed by it. That's truly the only occasion when you can use the word awesome. Please, just because ice cream tastes good, please don't use the word awesome. It's not awesome, all right? It's nice, but it's not awesome. Awesome when we see Jesus in all his glory, all shining, his clothes like lightning, and he took upon himself the resurrected form as a preview for the disciples to understand what he means by a resurrected body. Glorified, shining, beautiful. And then the next, N stands for no death, no disease, no blemishes, no loss of hair, no death. That is the wonderful thing about the resurrected body. Death will not touch, because it's already overcome death. E stands for eternal. Eternal is not just last a long, long time. But the Bible talks about eternal life. It talks about fullness of life. You can enjoy life. You can eat, but for fun. You don't need to eat to survive. And then T. Have you got a word there, T? One more. I invented a word here for trying to find a word. I use the word tally. You know why I used the word SingNet? Because SingNet is one way you can communicate without even a line. You know, you use the internet and you go through the sound. you can communicate. So tele talks about communication. That means you can communicate without need for MRT. You don't need to book a ticket. You don't need to ride on a plane. Some people think they can, they are like Superman. They, there was a story once I read about this proud man called Ali, Muhammad Ali. He was a boxer, as you know. And he, one day was on a flight and on a plane, and he refused to put on his safety belt. And so the gracious attendant said, "Sir, please fasten your seat belt." And this proud Ali said, "Superman needs no seat belt." The witty attendance lady said, "Sir, but Superman don't ride in no planes." So teleportation involves riding in no planes. You just travel as you wish. Well, you see this story of Superman flying here and there. Well, it's not exactly like that. But you move. All these describe the resurrected body of Jesus. This is only part of it. I don't know how you feel, but if you have all these elements, would you think it's worth having this kind of body? This kind of looks? You know, when you call glorified, means it's a beautiful look. So Jesus didn't have any more of those blood flowing out. Yes, there's a sign of scars in certain parts, but his body was perfect. In short, this is a perfect body. Now, that's the body of Jesus. He has to have power to create this body. That's why there was a great earthquake. The book of Ephesians says that Jesus was raised with great power. Power is involved. And a resurrected body involves power to create. Now, my question to you, do you know why Jesus rose from the dead? He didn't have to come and show us a resurrected body. He did it for our benefit. The Bible says that he's the first fruit, the firstborn from the dead. It sounds like a birth. The resurrection is a new birth. You must be birthed into this, then you get this resurrected life. But Jesus also said, because I will rise, because I rise, you also will, provided you walk by faith with Jesus. So the resurrected body of Jesus is only not only to show us what it's like, but it's something Jesus said, I rose so that you also will rise. Didn't he say, I'm the resurrection and the life. If any man believe in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live, and yet live not in the same way, but live with a new body. Not the overweight body, not the weak legs and feeble knees body, but a body that is super fit. That is the reason why Jesus rose. And he tried to explain this in so many ways, but nobody seems to understand. Because the alternative is a dreadful body. Didn't Jesus talk about the two Lazaruses? Didn't they know about a little bit of this resurrected body? He talked about this Lazarus that he raised from the dead, but the Lazarus who was raised from the dead came alive but did not have a resurrected body. Only Jesus had. Then Jesus talked about another Lazarus who was a poor man who was sick, and he died, and he went to another place called paradise. And there was a rich man who dressed better, ate better, lived better, also died and went to a place the Bible calls hell or Hades. Only a resurrected body can take the glory of God. There is a place called hell that everybody would go because of rejecting Jesus. Do you know we don't go to hell because we are sinner? Yes, because of sin we are to be punished, but we don't go to hell because we are sinners. We go to hell because we reject the resurrection of Jesus. The angel said, he has risen, but we say, I don't believe. I don't accept. Yet, those who accept Jesus by faith and walk with him, you also will rise again, Jesus said. You will also receive a resurrected body like his. That's what Paul said, like his. And do you know that's really worth it? Aim at all costs to get the resurrected body. Some of you may feel, well, you know, Pastor, my, you know, this, I'm not very healthy. The doctors say, you know, cancer is so common. Some of us here, maybe we have got medical examination that has caused you to be very discouraged. One of the most common is what we call the prostate marker for men. When the prostate marker increases, it causes a lot of fear in men because they call it as a precursor for cancer. Cancer is a frightening word. The resurrected body has no cancer. The power of the resurrection causes cancer cells to die. And we don't even have to wait until the day we die before we get the resurrected body. That power is also available for now when we walk by faith. That's why Paul said, that's what my ambition is. That I might understand and attain to one thing, the power of the resurrection. That's worth anything in the world. And then, I don't mind the fellowship of his sufferings because the power of the resurrection, the joy of the resurrection is so good that anything matters little. So there are some of us here maybe who have been unwell, and cancer is always that frightening word we don't want to hear about. Right now, COVID is something that has been with us for how many, 12 months or more. Nobody likes to know about COVID. Everybody is afraid of COVID. COVID-19 is something that we all want to get rid of. We look forward to the day when COVID-19 will be behind us. But folks, what happens if COVID-20 comes? Not 20, 20 is already still happening. 19 has followed us into 20 and 21. But let's say COVID-25. Hey, because these viruses keep on changing, right? But because of the resurrection, it doesn't matter what COVID. The day will come when you will have a body that is not subject to disease. It'll be a perfect body. That's why the message of the resurrection is the most important message for every person on planet Earth. COVID-19 or COVID anything cannot touch you. We need the resurrected body so that when we appear before God, the radiation will not eat us up. Because God is full of radiance. You need the resurrected body. Jesus came so that we will have the resurrected body. So why are you not considering and desiring this body? That's why, because we look forward to the resurrected body, we want to live a life that is holy. People think, oh, you mean become a Christian is so miserable? No. Because when I walk in the power of the resurrection, I don't have to walk in sin. I don't have to depend on pornography to make life interesting. I look forward to the day when I will attain to it. Paul says, my ambition is to attain to the resurrection of Jesus. Make it your ambition, your desire as well, because when you attain to it, you'll find that the attractions of sin, the attractions of pornography or drugs or the fear of disease or whatever, cancer, matters not, because all are temporal. Permanent blessing is the resurrected body. Jesus came to give it to us. And so what must we do? All right, we have talked about what happened on Easter morning. We have talked about what is a resurrection body. It's a wonderful body, a body that you will, it's a perfect body. Look forward to it. Live a life of holiness, because without holiness, no man can see the Lord. All right. Habitual sinning takes away our desire for the resurrection body. Habitual sinning takes away that love for that resurrected body. We lose sight of it. Habitual anger and unforgiveness takes away our desire for that day when we will see Jesus face to face and have a similar kind of body that he has, a perfect one. So the third thing I want to talk about a little bit quickly would be the evidence. You know, everybody wants to say that, oh, you know, sometimes people hear about resurrection, they say, oh, it sounds too good. Oh, it's your opinion, you know, you Christian think it's wonderful, it may be something airy-fairy. Is there evidence? Plenty. I normally have about eight key evidences. But today, I presume I'm speaking a lot to Christians, so I'll just touch two or three. The most important one is the empty tomb. We are not talking about evidence why we believe the resurrection is real. Because God knew that these people is going to ask a lot of questions. People will question it. It's okay. And the first evidence is the empty tomb. All right. These are all in your notes. The empty tomb. But the empty tomb is not so empty. You know, first of all, you need to know something about this tomb. This tomb is hewn out of a granite rock. Where does the Bible say it's a granite? Well, the Bible doesn't say. It's just that I used to, you know, one of the blessings of doing NS, National Service, was I was the first batch of combat officer to be commissioned. And the day I was commissioned, I was sent to Israel for training. We were the first batch to learn about armor warfare and armor maintenance and armor, you know, how the tanks are going to be maintained. I was responsible to set up the maintenance system for all the tanks. I understand some of you are from the armor section. Okay, that's so. I was in the first batch and I was stationed at a place not far from Jerusalem. So weekends I would take the bus. Number 56, I always remember. I take bus 56 from Benjamin Street and I'll head for Jerusalem many weekends. I like to go to the tomb of Jesus. And in those days, it was in 1968, soon after the war. You remember the major six-day war where the Israelites won a major battle and occupied all the way to Egypt. And so weekends I would drop by to Jerusalem, just take a short bus journey, and I would sit at the tomb, outside the tomb. In those days, they didn't fence up the tomb, so you could go in right inside the tomb. It was quite spacious, enough height if you stand up. And it goes an empty room, and then empty means open space, and then it goes into the side door, and then there was two granite slabs, and obviously to chisel out from granite rock is not only expensive but takes a long time. Only rich people can do so. Only the super rich can afford it, because it will cost too much to chisel out from granite. And the Old Testament prophecy said Jesus would be buried in the tomb of a rich man. Joseph of Arimathea owned it, and Jesus was put inside there. But the wonderful thing is this: although Jesus was not there, the tomb was not really empty. It has a shell. What is a shell? It's a shell of the tape that was wound around the body of Jesus. You know, in the Jewish way of doing it, things is they will put herbs and then they will use a tape, just like a bandage, and it will roll around the body many, many times, layer by layer, layer by layer. And the Bible says 50 kilograms of herbs was used. 50 kilograms. How many of you can lift up 50 kilograms with one hand? Some of you only wear 50, little bit over 50 kilograms. Correct or not? There are not many 80 kilogram people here, I see. Mostly, especially ladies, I think, Aga, you are 55 kg. Right or not? All right, now. That is a body weight of herbs wound around his body. That means after Jesus had already been all taped up from foot to head, they start with the foot, to right to the head, all wind again and again, layer by layer, and each layer they apply the herbs and the material for to preserve his body. And by the time he was ready for putting into the tomb, you need three persons to carry, because the body will be quite big. It will already weigh about 120 kilograms to 130 kilograms. How many of us can carry 100 kilograms? So you can say several people were involved to place it on the body of Jesus. So when Jesus rose from the dead, a lot of power was released, and what happened? Just like a butterfly, when it comes out of the chrysalis, out of the shell, there is always violent shaking. So in a way, the body of Jesus had vaporized and came out, but the shell was still there. The shell would probably weigh about 50, 60 kg left behind. It was visible to who? Well, the lady saw it, because the angel said, come and see. So the angel ushered them in. The ladies had the first preview. Who else saw that empty shell? Obviously, the soldiers must have seen it, because when they went back, they reported to the religious leaders that the body wasn't there anymore. Yeah, the shell was there, but the body was not there anymore. It had vaporized and come out. It is no more in the tomb. This, even the soldiers knew it. That's why when they reported, they said the body was no more there. All right, now, the empty tomb, but it's not empty. The body was missing. And then that was the empty tomb. Of course, by the time I visited this tomb, it was really empty. Yes, it was swept clean. Now, then there is the second evidence. It's called witnesses, multitude of witnesses. Period over 40 days. 500 people have seen him. And on the last day when he ascended, hundreds were there present, watching the ascension of Jesus. Third evidence. So this is many witnesses. The third evidence that every Christian must be able to repeat, what are these evidences? If you are a Christian, you say you believe in the resurrection of Jesus, you must be able to give evidence. And not say, otherwise someone will say, oh, that's your opinion. No, it's not my opinion. I remember I had a colleague, a very good friend of mine who is a Muslim, well-educated Muslim colleague. So sometimes he would ask me to go to movies with him. One time he asked me to go to a movie called The Exorcist. I said, why do you want me to come? He said, frightening. At least you will come alongside. Huh? If I'm frightened, I got somebody, you know, next to me. So I would go to the movies with this Muslim friend. And one day my Muslim friend gave me a tape. He said, hey, this is a tape by a chap called Dida. You know, my Muslim, one of the famous Muslim teachers. So I've got this thing. He asked, would you like to listen to this tape? You know, in those days, you have these cassette tapes. So he gave it to me. He said, okay, I'll go and listen. So after I listened, I took back to him. I spoke to my Muslim friend. Hey, what do you think? First question he asked me, what do you think? Who is right? Josh McDowell, who said there's resurrection. Mr. Didat said there's no resurrection. Which way you think is evidence goes? And I asked him, you tell me first. I said, we are friends. So, you know, we discuss religion in a friendly manner. I said, you tell me first. He said, I think Josh McDowell won the debate because Josh McDowell produced evidence. But I said, Didat also produced evidence. Yeah, but Didat's evidence did not hold water. Didat said Jesus didn't die. But you know, after all the flogging, if you didn't die, the soldiers poke a spear into his side. If he still didn't die, he would probably be dead by the time they wind all the herbs into his body. He would not be able to breathe. He would die anyway. So my friend said, yes, I believe Jesus rose again from the dead. So 3-4 key evidence. 1, the empty tomb, but not so empty. 2, what is it? Multitude of witnesses. 3, alternative arguments cannot explain the resurrection. 4, I would say the investigators' report. In fact, number of investigators, some of them are Christians, some of them are non-Christian. One of the first investigator report is done by a chap called Dr. Luke. And Dr. Luke, in his preface, and he wrote the Gospel of Luke, he wrote this. I have carried out detailed investigation into this regarding Jesus, especially about his resurrection. And I have got many proofs. I know your English translation is right, convincing evidence. And in the book of Luke, in the book of Acts, chapter 1, Luke repeated again. He said, following my investigation, there was many proofs that Jesus rose from the dead. Some people say there's no proof. Some Christians say there's no proof Jesus, there's really no proof Jesus rose from the dead. That's not correct. Luke says there were many proofs. What does proof mean? Proof means that it is shown beyond doubt. That's proof. But subsequently, from the first century onwards, every few years, people will come up with this idea that the resurrection is not true. So later on, you've got some legal minds, famous legal minds, people like Ingersoll, who was a lawyer, army lawyer, who went up to, he's an atheist, and he went out to investigate to show that Jesus didn't rise from the dead. And when he investigated, he found all the information and the proofs. He concluded Jesus did rise from the dead. And what did he do with all the materials he gathered? He wrote that book, Ben-Hur. Some of you have seen that movie called Ben-Hur. Another man, later on called Morrison, Morrison was another lawyer who went out to the Middle East to investigate, to prove that Jesus did not rise from the dead. But after all his investigations, he put a book together called Who Moved the Stone? Of course, we all know the answer, right? The angel one. His title of his book called Who Moved the Stone? So there's evidence. So he outlines why he said that Jesus did rise from the dead. So there are many, many investigations. There are many others, people like Craig Lane, there's words like Gary Habermas. There are many, many investigators into the evidence of the resurrection. Study for yourself. But not a single Christian who goes and tell doesn't know how to tell what the evidences are. The command of the angel was go and tell. Then finally, Jesus met the woman. What is the instruction? Go and tell. Because the more you go and the more you tell, this is the instruction. Tell. Tell about what? The resurrection of Jesus. So we'll talk about what happened on Easter morning. We'll talk about what are the features of the resurrected body. Thirdly, I've talked to you briefly about the evidence of the resurrection. Every Christian must know this. And then lastly, I just want to talk about, so what are we going to do about it? How does this benefit us? What should we do about it? The first thing Jesus tell us about we are to do is to go and tell. If that resurrection is something you believe, you will talk about it. You will decide. You will, like Paul said, set a goal that I will attain to the resurrection. How do you do it? Well, when you come to Jesus by faith, when you walk with Jesus, when you walk in obedience to Him, do not depart from a relationship with Jesus. Continue until the day of death, because the resurrection can only take place after physical death. You cannot have a physical body, natural body, and supernatural body. Now, the Bible says that death is an appointment. Everybody has an appointment. It is an appointed unto man once to die. But in the resurrection, Jesus set another appointment, a different appointment. He says to the disciples, go to a place, Galilee. In fact, he set this appointment before he even was crucified. Jesus has an appointment. He sets an appointment for you and me so that we have the resurrected life. There is on the other side the appointment of death. Death can be brought about by sin. And you know, when we come to the resurrection of Jesus, some of you have not really come to the point where you tell Jesus, yes, Lord, I want the same resurrection life that you promise. It comes by faith. It comes by a covenant. That's an important word. So if you have never received this, how do you get this resurrected life? It is received by a covenant. A covenant means an agreement. Agreement, what kind of agreement? We make a covenant with Jesus that we will trust Him for everything. We'll say yes to Jesus for everything He says in His book. That means Jesus said, if you want to have a covenant with me, it's a covenant of love. Jesus loved us. But question is, do you love Jesus? Jesus said this, if any man have my commandments and keeps them, he is the one who loves me. And resurrection life comes to us through a covenant relationship with Jesus. So if you have never made this covenant with Jesus, I want to give you an opportunity shortly to make this covenant with Jesus, telling him, Jesus, I'm going to say yes to you. I'm going to follow you into the resurrected life. I want to receive it for myself. Like Paul, I'll set the resurrection life as my life ambition. I'll trade nothing for it. It will be the most precious thing that I desire. You come into a covenant with Jesus where you have said, Lord Jesus, I will believe you. I'll trust you all the days of my life. I'll trust your word. You cannot say, Jesus, I trust you, but I am not interested in your word. Because it is only by his word that we trust. You see, we trust Jesus on the basis of his promises. So you say, I got no time to read the promises. You basically got no time for the resurrected life. The resurrected life begins now as we follow his promises in his word. Even Peter, who saw the resurrected Jesus, even Peter said, I was there on that mountain when Jesus was crucified, was transformed. Yet I go according to his written word for my faith. So you come by faith. This covenant is a faith covenant where you trust what Jesus says. If you have never believed in Jesus, you have never made a covenant with Jesus to enter in the resurrection life, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do so. I'm going to ask you shortly when we pray, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand as an indication to God that I want to make a transaction with you. After you finish, then we are not supposed to mingle around. So you tell one of your friends who is a Christian that you have made your covenant with Jesus. All right. And so let's bow your head. There's a close. I'm going to give you an opportunity to. You have learned a lot about what happened on Easter morning. You have learned about the beauty and the greatness of the resurrected life. Something you will covet at all costs. And if this is the case, I like all heads bowed, all eyes closed. And I just want you, if today you have never made this covenant with Jesus, and as an indication to Jesus this morning that you want to enter into that covenant relationship so that the resurrected life of Jesus will be yours, then I'm going to count to three, and I'd like you to just raise your hand quickly and put it down. All right. So this is what I want you to do. Because the resurrected life cannot be received without an agreement, all right, without faith, without trusting Jesus, without making a transaction. I'm going to count to three, and if you want to believe in Jesus for the first time, you are saying yes to Jesus, yes to the resurrected life, then can you just lift our hand when I count to three. I'm going to start counting. One, two, three. Yes, I saw your hand. I see your hand. Thank you. Put it down. And for those who have already believed in Jesus, you said you believe in the resurrected life. You have received Jesus by faith. But the command Jesus says is, go and tell. Don't keep it to yourself. There are many, I had a dream, in fact, last night. I was walking in a forest and I heard a cry of help. Someone was in trouble. It was in a dark forest. And I heard this cry for help. And I wasn't quite sure where this person was. And I rushed in the direction of the sound. But I realized that this is a picture of the world today. People are in darkness. They are rushing. They are crying out for help. But sometimes we are too preoccupied. We got no time to go and tell. We are too self-conscious. Sometimes we keep saying we don't know how. But Jesus says, go and tell. Father in heaven, I bless your people even as we know the beauty and the wonder and the joy of the resurrection. Lord, may each of us be committed to maintain our relationship, just like Paul did, that at all costs, he pursued the resurrected life that is available in Christ Jesus. So I pray right now that, Lord, you put in the desire of every one of our hearts that the resurrected life is the thing that we'll never exchange for anything in the world, that will walk with Jesus, that will take hold of eternal life, that will walk in obedience, will take hold of your word and your promises, so that our faith in the risen Christ will be maintained. So, Lord, fill each one of us with a deep desire to attain to the power of the resurrection, not just in eternity, but here and now. I pray this, we pray this, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.